The celebration continues. Ladies and gentlemen, again, I thank you from the bottom of my heart for getting me to 100,000 subscribers. I am so proud of all of you and how far we have collectively come. We now have a thriving community of gamers, scholars, I think you can say, differently wired people, of course, and some combination of all three. I intend to keep this community growing well into the future with more thought-provoking and therapeutic content. However, before our work continues, we must take a step back and remember to celebrate our achievements. So, today, as a part of my ongoing celebration of having hit 100,000 subscribers, I present to you a topic recommended by one of the members of my Discord server named Thortle. I think I'm pronouncing that right. They suggested that I count down my top 10 favorite games, and I am about to do just that. But before I do, I just wanted to remind some of you that the final thing I am doing as a part of my celebration is another Q&A. If you have any questions that you'd like me to answer, please click on the link in the description box below to go to my Q&A announcement video. Leave your question in the comment section of that video, and I will answer it in an upcoming video. With that out of the way, I will now present to you my top 10 favorite games ever. These are not what I regard as the greatest games ever made, they are merely my favorites. I think for most of you, the top 2 games will be obvious, but aside from those two, I think you will be surprised by what made it on the list. Actually, no, I think you might be more surprised about what didn't make it on the list. Anyways, I'd like to know if anything surprised you guys. Do any of my top 10 games show up on your list? Please let me know in the comment section below. I do have one honorable mention that is not on the list, but I feel it deserves recognition. World of Warcraft. I have subscribed to World of Warcraft twice in my life. Once around the time that the Burning Crusade expansion came out, and once, I think, when Mists of Pandaria came out. Both times, I played obsessively for several months until I was forced to make a decision. Do I let this game consume my entire being, or do I unsubscribe and take back control of my life? Thankfully, in both cases, I chose the latter. Now, don't get me wrong, this isn't a condemnation of those who play World of Warcraft, okay? Some of my best friends play the game much more than I ever did, and they lead highly productive lives. I'm just speaking as somebody who has an addictive personality. I got seriously addicted to World of Warcraft because the game is unlike anything else. It is so much fun. The world is enormous, there's an endless stream of content that will take you years to get through. There are these wonderful communities, guilds that you can join where you can make lifelong friendships with people, and it's rewarding as all hell. Just thinking about it right now, I kind of wish I could go back to it and play it because I have so many great memories playing that game, but like I said, it would be like an alcoholic who has been sober for decades going back to the bottle, you know? If you have never played World of Warcraft and have self-control, I highly recommend you play it at least once in your life. Now, with that out of the way, let's get to the actual list. First up at number 10, and this is gonna make some of you laugh, Minecraft. Yeah, the autist likes Minecraft. Who would have thunk? But look, like with World of Warcraft, there's a reason why so many people play it so many years after its initial release. You can literally build almost anything that comes to your mind. When I first understood what I could do with Minecraft, my imagination went buck wild. I had to create these huge contraptions that spontaneously burst into my mind. Because of that, I have wasted months of my life playing this game. And I spent most of my time playing Minecraft on the Xbox 360. I was building these huge cities in buildings without mods, just using creative mode and a crap ton of TNT. Man, I have to go find my 360 so I can show you guys the crazy stuff I built. That is, if it's still around somehow. I don't know how it all works. But yeah, I don't play Minecraft as much as I used to nowadays, for the same reason I don't play World of Warcraft anymore. I do like going into Minecraft on PC though, like downloading people's maps and doing graphical showcases in my YouTube videos, but aside from that, nah, I can't do it. However, I have many great memories with the game, and by the way, if you guys have any Minecraft creations that you would like me to film and put in my videos, let me know. Send me an email so I can join your game sometime and film what you got. My email address is in the description box. Alright, coming in at number 9 is Pokemon Crystal. Oh my god. Oh my god. Yeah, my childhood was this game. I think it was pretty much everybody's childhood. In fact, I think it's fair to say that Pokemon Crystal was probably my first gaming addiction. I played so much Pokemon Crystal back in the day, man. It was all me and my friends ever talked about in the bus, at recess. We'd show up at school one day, we'd be hanging out at recess and talk about which Pokemon we have on our team, our stats, whether we caught Lugia or Ho-Oh yet. One of my fondest memories, I remember this moment distinctly. I was sitting in the car for about half an hour while my mother was inside the grocery store, and she would let me do that as long as the temperature outside wasn't too hot or too cold, right? And while she was in there, I was playing Pokemon Crystal, and I came across Entei and Raikou all in the course of half an hour. Now, if you guys know anything about Pokemon, you know how unlikely an occurrence like that is. And I also caught them, too. That was a proud moment in my childhood, but anyways, I'm kind of surprised that my Pokemon addiction didn't continue after that. I played a bit of Ruby and Sapphire, but I never played any of the other games after that, like, what is it, Black and White, Diamond and Pearl, I think? Yeah, I never played any of those. I think I was just starting to get into Halo at the time, and I had to choose either that or Pokemon. Man, if Game Freak and Nintendo ever decide to do, like, a Pokemon MMO, like a World of Warcraft style kind of thing, I don't care if it ruins my life. My life would be worth ruining over a Pokemon MMO, but anyways, that's many years off. So yeah, Pokemon Crystal is my number 9. My number 8 is Super Smash Bros. Melee. Whenever I went over to a friend's house, this is all we would do. Just turn on Smash and waste the hours. And you know, this is the case for all of us. Our parents would be like, oh, look at them wasting away in front of a TV when they could spend that energy outside or doing something productive. Man, I have no regrets. Zero regrets. Some of my happiest memories were just playing Smash with my friends, man. I love Melee so much. It's interesting too, because like Pokemon, I didn't play much of any other entry that came out, even though I loved Melee a lot. Like, I had a Wii and I had Brawl, but I didn't play it anywhere near as much as I played Melee. I'm not really sure what happened, but whatever. My main character for Smash is and always has been Link. Even to this day, when I have briefly played the new editions of Smash on Wii U and Switch, like if I went over to a friend's house, I can still kick ass with Link, okay? Provided that I'm using a GameCube controller, that is. Anyways, anybody who has ever played Smash knows how good it is. I don't need to go into greater depth. On to number 7. My number 7 is Halo 2. Interestingly enough, out of all of the Halo campaigns, I think Halo 2 had the second worst campaign out of all of them, with Halo 5 obviously being the worst. However, the multiplayer for this game, dude. If any of you were on Xbox Live back in the day, you understand what I'm talking about. The multiplayer for this game was so good, so much fun, that it completely overrode my complaints about the campaign. The basic gameplay of Halo 2 is still so much fun and still so finely tuned that I can put on a game of Slayer on Ivory Tower and have as much fun as I did when I was 11 years old. Now, even though the graphics are hella dated, obviously, the gameplay is still immaculate in my eyes. Not only that, but the hours I spent with my friends just trying to glitch the game and get to out of bounds areas. Oh man, like, that was sometimes even more fun than just the matchmaking, you know? Do you guys remember the super bounces? Or the sword canceling glitch you could do to get to unreachable areas? Or that one place on Coagulation that you could drive the tank to flip it, and then you could drive a tank on top of it to send it flying? Oh, I remember laughing so hard at that shit. I thought I was literally going to die because I couldn't breathe. I was laughing so hard. Yeah, if you tried to get somebody who never played Halo 2 to play it today, admittedly, they probably wouldn't get what's so great about it. But those of us who played it back in the day, you know. You know. Alright, number 6. Some of you might have expected this game to be somewhere on the list. Half-Life 2. I think I would go so far as to say that this is one of the top 10 greatest games ever made. Right up there with, like, Ocarina of Time, Resident Evil 4, maybe the original Red Dead Redemption. When this game came out, it exceeded not only expectations, but industry standards. It's an archetypal first-person shooter. In my opinion, the game holds up to this day. roughly 20 years after its initial release, and not many games can do that. I mean, yeah, obviously the graphics aren't up to snuff, but the gameplay is. Chopping up zombies with the gravity gun is still fun as shit. You guys remember that giddiness you felt when you picked up one of those saw blades and shot it through a zombie's sternum? That, oh, and Ravenholm is still scary and fun as hell. And that end level where you could just go ham with the super gravity gun? Guys, there is a reason why people are still demanding Half-Life 3 12 years after the last Half-Life game. It's because Half-Life 2 really is that good. If you have never played Half-Life 2, play it. Do it. Now. It's about as close to a perfect game that you can get. Alright, number 5 is a bit of a cheat for me because to this day, I still can't choose which of the two I like better. GTA San Andreas or GTA 5. Sandbox games are my bread and butter. I love them. They're my favorite game genre. And both of these games are about as good as they can get. Now, I understand the complaints about GTA 5 Online's monetization crap, and those are perfectly valid complaints. The thing is, though, the gameplay in GTA 5 single player and the multiplayer are just so good at times. Even if the grind is unbearable for some people, and I totally understand why, the gameplay is nonetheless fun. I still have a blast doing heists and stunt races or just messing around in free mode. And of course, like I just briefly mentioned, the single player for GTA 5 is still one of the best that you can get. I still say Red Dead Redemption 2 single player is the best that Rockstar has ever done, but I think the consistent quality of both GTA 5's single player and multiplayer is higher than RDR2's. Now, in regards to San Andreas, oh man, when I was a kid and I found out that there was a game I could play where I could fly a jet, jump out of it, parachute to the ground, and then tear stuff up with a Gatling gun? Okay, you can imagine as a 12-year-old how happy that idea made me. It's a young boy's dream. It blew my mind. So I had as much fun playing San Andreas as I did playing GTA 5, and I honestly can't choose which one I liked more. Depending on what day of the week it is, I might say one or the other. Man, Rockstar makes some amazing games. It's just such a shame that the quality of their games is so good that they get away with some of their more recent practices, you know? Okay, we're getting up there now. Number 4 might surprise some of you because I've never talked about this franchise before. Also, compared to all the other games on this list, it's not going to be considered one of the all-time greats. However, to me, Prince of Persia, The Sands of Time, is one of the best single-player experiences I have ever had. The world is unique and mysterious, the combat is finely tuned, the puzzles can be a little bit tough but are always rewarding, and the reverse time mechanic is spectacular. It's so good that I find myself wishing that more games could implement it, but then of course, after 2 seconds of thinking about it, you realize that would be difficult to implement without plagiarism and yada yada yada. Although Braid did it and everybody loved Braid. Anyways, look, just Ubisoft, stop being jackasses, okay? Nobody wants Ghost Recon Breakpoint, okay? We want Prince of Persia, Splinter Cell, okay? Go back to doing stuff like that. Instead of the stuff that's making you, like, diet EA, you know, quasi-EA. Like, not as bad as EA, but still not good. Come on. Anyways, Prince of Persia, The Sands of Time, I love it. I can still play it to this day because it's a well-refined experience. I highly recommend it. Alright, my number 3 might seem high to a lot of you, and fair enough. I put it here for sentimental reasons. My number 3 is Spyro 3. Year of the Dragon. Yeah, when this game came out, I think I was like 6 or 7. It's this high because it's one of the foundational games that made me the gamer I am today. It was easy to pick up. You had a dragon as your protagonist, which is always cool. You had this colorful, enchanting world with puzzles that ranged in difficulty. And also, you got the skateboard, which is always cool, especially in the 90s when that was like the thing that all the cool kids did. Spyro 3 took everything that was great about Spyro 1 and 2 and just perfected it. With the exception of the music, in my opinion, because out of all three, I think Spyro 2 had the best music, but that's totally subjective. Plus, Spyro 3 is one of the first games ever that I completed 100%, which was obviously a proud achievement for somebody that was like, I think I was 8 or 9 when I perfected it. Yeah, Spyro is awesome. There's a reason why it got remastered recently, and it's because the platforming mechanics, while basic, I think you can say, are nonetheless finely tuned. Kind of like Super Mario Brothers in a way. If you have kids and you want to introduce them to games, Spyro is a magnificent way to start, and I guarantee they will love it. Okay, now we're in the top two. I'm sure you all know what number one is, but you might not know what number two is. It's a game I've talked about extensively on this channel. It's a game that continues to capture my imagination a full decade after I originally played it. And in my opinion, it holds up entirely a full 15 years after its release. Yes, indeed, my number two is Shadow of the Colossus. I know some of you are like, wait, what? If that's your number two, then your number one can only be one of two things, which means the thing I thought you would have on your list is, yeah, okay. We'll discuss that in the comment section, but anyways, Shadow of the Colossus. It doesn't matter whether you play the original PS2 version or the more recent remaster, which I think is free on PlayStation Plus right now, or it might have just stopped being free, I can't remember. The game stands the test of time in almost every way possible. No matter what version you play, the landscapes are breathtaking, the lore is captivating, the mood is melancholy yet meaningful, and the gameplay, in my opinion, is perfect. It's perfect. You have these epic battles against enormous beasts, each battle being a puzzle of how to get on the beast and reach its weak points. And then you have these tranquil, contemplative moments where you're just riding your horse across the barren wasteland, which sounds boring, but it really isn't. If it was, it wouldn't be on like every top 50 list of games ever. If you consider yourself a gamer, Shadow of the Colossus is one of those games that you have to play. It's mandatory. Much like a Zelda game or a Mario game or whatever. To this day, I still have dreams about slaying more giant monsters than just the 16 the game provides. Like, literal dreams. It's because I so desperately want to go back to that world and relive that initial experience. I really hope that if you, the listener, have never played Shadow of the Colossus, that you will allow yourself to have that magical experience sometime in your life. Finally, my number one. If you've been following my channel since its inception, you should know what it is. Yeah, it's obviously Metal Gear Solid 2. I mean, duh, like obviously. If it weren't for this game, I would have no channel. The story of that game single-handedly made me the person I am today. That final codec conversation, the single most profound moment in gaming history, has messed me up to this day. It encouraged me to think and not just live inside an unconscious echo chamber like so much of the world does. The game inspired me to seek out other profound games and promote their narrative brilliance. It is thanks to Metal Gear Solid 2 that I dream one day of lecturing classrooms about the subtle, life-changing brilliance that video games harbor in their stories. And man, I haven't even gotten to the excellent gameplay that Metal Gear Solid 2 provides. I think it holds up, even to this day. Yeah, I mean, sure, the stealth mechanics aren't as sophisticated as they are in Metal Gear Solid 5, or like any of the other ones, but everything else is still so tightly refined. I hope one day that I will come across a game that has another life-changing moment like that final codec conversation. Some games that have come out since then do have great moments, like the ending of Nier Automata, the first Bioshock, and lots more, but in my opinion, none have risen up to the majesty of MGS2. So, that's my list. Do you like my choices? Do you think some of the games I've chosen are overrated? Please let me know in the comment section below. If you are so inclined, maybe leave your own top 10 list. I'd love to discuss them with you. I'll have my eye on the comment section over the next couple of weeks, so don't think I will skip over it. And before you go, make sure you hit that like button. It's free and it helps me out a lot. And until my next video, which, by the way, will be on that game, which a lot of you expected to be on my list but wasn't, I just want to remind you, stay yellow.